nostalgia. I found you when I heard the sweet sound of the ones who I once knew so well. In a voice memo from years ago, we were laughing about some nonsense. Oh, how I miss those friends. Circumstances made it so that I'll never see their faces, except for on the internet.
Hi. Before we get into it, Katie, is that free music?
Yes, it is.
Oh, solid. Okay, cool. I wasn't sure. Hi, yes. Everybody. First of all, thank you to Katie for making our new intro for the summertime.
Woo!
In the summer. What is that? Is that a song? Something about Chinese food? Chinese food makes me sick in the summer? Anyway, it doesn't matter. I have no idea where my brain just went. Anyway.
Did I enter an alternate dimension? What the fuck?
Welcome to Walls Glitching Out right at the start of the stream. Hi guys, it's Sprints and Shop Talk this week on the Trouble stream. Grape Fry was here 5 minutes ago and then she yeeted out, so she might be experiencing some technical difficulties, but in case this is your first time, Sprints and Shop Talk is when I'm hosting the Trouble stream and I ask questions of my co-hosts, typically related to Shop Talk, although not really this past year, that's fine. And then also of the audience, they are welcome to participate in the questions as well. But before we jump in to the Sprints and Shop Talk, how are my co-hosts doing today? Stieg?
I am doing as well as one can do with a tummy ache. Nothing serious. I think I just had dairy. And do I not handle dairy anymore? Because that would be tragic.
Oh, no.
But other than that, I'm fine. The weather is really nice. I get to hang out with my besties. You know, what could possibly be better?
So Nothing. Catherine, with her new haircut and hair color.
Yes. It's shockingly on camera, it kind of looks the same as it did last week, like color-wise.
It looks lighter.
No, it
does.
Your lighting?
Okay.
Can you turn up your computer brightness so people can really see?
I have it up all the way.
Oh. Well, you guys, she is ginger. She's like...
Ginger. Like full
light.
Ginger.
Light red as opposed to her classic like dark red.
I also got layers cut into my hair, so it's a lot fluffier and I have curtain bangs.
She is giving you volume for days.
She said,
I'm going to church every Sunday and I am close to God because my hair is tall.
Yes. Taller the hair, closer to God. Exactly. So I'm loving the volume. I'm loving this. Today though, I spilled my entire coffee on my vanity. Or not my vanity, my nightstand.
Good start.
So I will in fact have to be dealing with that in the first sprint, but it's fine. We're fine. We got towels on top of it to hopefully soak up most of the madness. And then we'll go from there. I don't know what happens after that, but we're good.
Devesha, how are you today? In and out.
Oh, in and out?
No, I just meant because you were here earlier and then you weren't.
Oh. Oh, yeah, sorry. I was backstage, and then I took the dog for bathroom time. And then my internet was like, oh, guess not. So it kicked me out. But we're here. We're queer. We're full of cheer, question mark.
Ooh.
You need to work on that. Let's workshop that.
Okay. Yeah.
Put well, on the books.
How are you, Miss Wallace?
Oh, I'm doing great. I've had a very productive week, which is super exciting because I feel like my next week is not going to be productive at all because the next 2 weeks are when my family is like all in one location. And so it's like party, party, party for 14 days straight. It's going to be super fun. So I've wanted to be quite productive this week, which I was. So yay. A round of applause for Wallissimo. But yeah, I think... Amazingly, 5 minutes into it, we're going to get into our first sprint. Just so people are aware, the theme this week is on location. Not that we are on location, although I am on location for one of my stories. One of my stories takes place in this very cottage and, in fact, in this very room. Some certain theme. And so, but I do want to say, I believe in a previous Sprints and Shop Talk, we did world building. This is not what we're discussing today. We're not discussing world building like politics and power structure and da-da-da. We're talking about within a scene, how you as a writer and you as a reader experience location. So just keep that in mind. The first question will come after the first sprint and we'll kind of follow our typical flow, our typical creative flow of me asking one of the co-hosts the question, doing a little bit of the comments, second co-host question, a little bit of the comments, et cetera, et cetera. Is everybody ready for a sprint?
We're not going to say how we're friends.
Why would we do that?
Hi, Bessie.
Hey, everybody. Hey. We're on location of our own locations. Hello, everybody. Nia Moon's here. Madison's here. Just up barely after binging all of Good Omens, new season. Oh, is that out? Nice. Z's here. Oh, see, people are really into the intro, except for Paris. It scared her, I guess. Cool Gamer's here. Hello. Hi, Jess.
Thank Katie you. Katie,
so pretty. Defacia. Heart, heart, heart.
Oh, I love
or
that.
Heart,
oh,
yeah.
Hi, Some Deep Mystery. Hi, Miranda. Oh my God, now I want in and out. Okay. Wait, I tricked you. How did I trick you? I don't know. Anyway, we're going to jump into our first sprint. Look at her. She's a go-getter. Somebody else talk while I share my screen. Woo!
If we do the sprint, we'd have to go through
intro. Is it good?
It was lovely. Very peaceful. Okay, the sprint's happening. Bye. the end of the first sprint. That's the break. Let me pause this and stop sharing my screen. All right, friends. I don't know why I'm doing this accent. Okay.
I love it.
You're muted, my darling. And how did you do?
I did well. I got through 27 out of my 33 pages of the day for beta reading. So.
Amazing.
Yeah. It's easy with the material is good.
I love to hear that.
So that's what I did. And yeah.
Pass it along to Catherine.
I cleaned up the coffee that was spilled. I made myself a matcha and I wrote 251 words. So we're cooking with gas this morning.
Wow. More like Slady and Ginger.
Grapefruit, are you here? You popped in and out a couple times during the stream, I think. I kept hearing someone pop in and out.
It was Grape in the library with the candelabra.
Well, anyway, I did well as well. I am editing. I am really enjoying editing. First of all, I'm listening to a new ambient music thing. And first of all, I want to point this out because this is hilarious. I just listened to an ambient playlist called A Play of Sweet Shredded Cheese at 3 a.m. And I felt finally content. I think I need to see a therapist. I love how specific some of these playlists are. Like, it's truly amazing. The one I was listening to was called Fairylands, Fantasy Music in a Magical Forest, Fantasy Ambiance. And I have to say, it was so calming and beautiful. But I also will say, I edited out a big chunk at the start of the chapter I'm editing because I felt like it was background information that broke up the action of the scene. But as I have continued reading the chapter, I realized why I had included that big chunk of background information because it was kind of important for the context of the rest of the chapter. So now I'm a little conflicted, I have to say. Okay.
Could you like divide it up and sprinkle it instead of just having an introduction?
Well, the thing is that it wasn't even that big of a chunk, right? It was like 75 words, which isn't really right. But it's kind of one of those things where it's like somebody says a line of dialogue and then you have this whole 75 word chunk and then the next line of dialogue happens. And so I took out that chunk so the two lines of dialogue could be together. So yeah, I'm wondering what to do with the chunk. Also, I really hate the word chunk, if anybody wonders.
I also hate that word. I was like, is she gonna say it again?
Robot Katie. Yeah. I always love the face Katie makes whenever I tell her she's robotic.
Yeah, it's just like, it's always such a surprise.
And it's always like, God damn it.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's see. How did everybody else do? Kelly managed to be themselves. That definitely counts. Laura says, I saw that Eat Shredded Cheese at 3 a.m. playlist. It recommended. Maybe Laura also needs therapy. Gay says, it's really good. Wendy loaded the dishwasher, made coffee, and read a few pages. I love that. That's great. Are we ready for the Shop Talk portion of this Benson Shop Talk?
Aye, aye, Captain.
And Sting's in the hot seat this week, guys.
I think that's why Katie and Grape showed up late. Because they were like, oh, my
wait, I do have a question. Did you guys go and scavenge for the questions or are you just flying blind? Do you know what I'm about to ask?
I know what you're about to ask. I didn't scavenge because they were very easy to find. So I just picked them off the top shelf.
Okay, nice.
And then I looked at them.
I also scavenged.
Oh, I'd love to hear it. I'm so thrilled that my students came prepared today. Okay.
It's called character growth.
I love this. I know. Could you imagine 2 years ago you guys doing this? Come on.
Absolutely not. How dare you?
All right. So our first
question. Grape said, you're going to give us homework now?
I know. Well, that originally was why I did Sprints and Shop Talk. It was to punish you guys because you forced me to host. And I was like, I never want to host ever. Thank you very much. And then they were like, well, Walt is hosting next week then. And I was like, you're so mean. All right, you guys. All right, Stieg, because Katie's going off to Discipline Blue or something. I don't know. She's talking to somebody. On location, how important is location setting to you when you write? And how about when you read? It's a two-parter question today.
Oh, okay. It seemed dreary to answer question number two first. I love a good descriptive location.
Okay.
I have a very hard time with smell, though, both in reading and writing. Smells, I can't really manifest smells in my brain, if that makes sense. Yeah. So if you says it smelled like, you know, death's front door or something, what is that?
That's like, a great description, though. Death's front door.
Yeah, but I feel like
I very viscerally react to that. I like that. Oh, the baby's here.
Oh, hello, child. Well,
okay, so like when I say something smells like warm apple pie, you can't smell
it. I just picture a warm apple pie. I don't smell it.
Yeah, that's fair. But do you feel the way you feel whenever you were to smell warm apple pie?
No.
Well, maybe warm apple pie is a bad example for you because apple pie is like very Americana. Do you eat apple pie a lot?
Yes, I am from something known as the Apple Orchard of Norway.
Oh, well, there you go. So then you would know what I'm talking about. Okay, that's interesting. Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe I don't have like the smell sensory bit because some people like can't see images and some come to color and stuff like that. But maybe I just don't know what a smell is.
Hold on. Katie, you do not give that dog a treat after he barks at you for a treat.
I made him sit down.
Yeah.
I said, sit.
Yeah, and then he sat, and then instead of giving it to him, you waited, and then he barked at you, and then you gave him the treat, which means you're
training. No, I didn't. No.
Woman, it was recorded.
Come here.
I'm sorry, Steve. This is totally interrupting our Shoptalk interview. Anyway, not me backseat training this dog. So, okay, so smell. Scent is very hard for you. Do you still try to utilize it, or are you just like...
I mean, yes, because at least in my writing, like... I try to be conscious about it because I never like subconsciously write things. Like I describe things like just automatically, but then I'm like, I should probably add some smells in here.
Okay.
So that's something I have to be conscious of when I write, or at least when I edit.
So you would say that scent is the hardest one for you. What do you think is the location setting, like sense that you have the easiest time tapping into?
Ooh. Any like farm related smell, just because it was such an integral part of my childhood because I grew up on a farm. So
scent. Scent is both the easiest and the hardest thing for you to tap into.
Oh, didn't you ask for the easiest scent?
Sense, sorry.
Oh, the easiest sense. So yeah, that makes more sense, if you will. the easiest sense to tap into, I would say like the visual. It's just so easy. Okay. So like basic. Mm. Also, audio I do pretty well with in terms of like picturing audio in a scene.
Picturing audio in a scene?
Yeah, like, do you know when you read a book and you get a scene in your head? Like, I always get the visuals and the audio in my head.
Like the birds, the rush of water.
Yeah, like a bustling tavern or like, you know, the open country road on the wagon. Stuff like
the
that.
Sound of the wagon, like clunk clunking over.
So I get that easy, but no scent.
What about like, how often do you utilize physical like touch and, you know, the chill of the air or the softness of a sheepskin woolen cloak? How often is that something you incorporate?
Weather I do pretty frequently. Mm-hmm. I love a good weather descriptor. I don't know why, mm-hmm. but clothes, not really. I should probably tap into that some bit more. I'm like, he's wearing a sweater.
Yeah.
But yeah, never like, was it called sensation? Is that a sense?
Yeah, I think so. I was
touch, to touch, maybe.
Touch, yeah.
Yeah, I'm also not very good at that. So.
So wait, what are all of them? It's eyes, smell, taste, sound, touch. And the sixth sense. How often do you incorporate psychic powers and ghosts into
locations? Honestly, I'm doing it frequently. Yeah, my character has visions.
Me too. Yeah.
So the sixth sense very much gets utilized.
Yeah. Actually, that's so funny because in the past, I have kind of questioned you guys about themes that pop up in your writing. You know, you deal a lot with parental like relationships. I have a lot of isolated women. I wanted to know if you think about it, are there any themes within your locations? Like for an example, this cottage that I'm currently in, I was really thinking about it and it's in like 8 of the stories I've written in my life, like a version of it. It's in the first book I ever went on submission with. It's in a short story that Katie just read of mine. That's like a futuristic sci-fi short story. It's in Tabitha. I mean, it is in so many of my projects. So I was wondering if there was a specific location. Is it like, do you incorporate farms a lot because you grew up on a farm or something like that?
No, I don't think so. I mean, yeah, no, I don't think so. I write a bunch of different stuff. So do you... I'm not like attached to a certain location, like as a motif.
But like you are from Norway, in case people didn't know. And in fact, Stig lives in the fjords of Norway. And as Grape would say, hey, Siri, what's a fjord? But for anybody who doesn't know, a fjord is this incredible natural feature where glaciers have come in.
How dare you when I'm not here?
I mean, you were there. I saw you backstage. I knew you were here to defend yourself. A fjord is when a glacier kind of carves out in mountains and near the sea. And then when the glacier melts away, you're left with this beautiful sea mountainscape that's like inlet into land. And so it's water and huge soaring mountains. So my question, Stig, is having kind of lived for so long in such a majestic landscape, how do you feel that serves your writing process? Do you pull from your home or do you envision wildly different landscapes when you write?
I feel like fjords is such a specific thing that I'm kind of hesitant to bring it into writing. Not because I'm like I don't know how to express it, but I feel like there's a certain, like, as you say, it's carved by a glacier. It takes thousands of years. It has to be an ice age. So it's like, it's not some field you can just have in your location without having to explain that there once was a glacier and there once was ice age. And like, at least
you
don't in my fantasy
world. That. You just say it's
I mean,
fjord.
In my brain, I have to explain it to myself.
Oh.
Not to the reader, but I'm like, there has to be a logical reason for there to be a glacier there. But in my current writing, I have actually incorporated fjords from a different kind of natural phenomena. I'm excited to get to that part of the novel so I can pull from all my knowledge and all my, you know, lived experience with fjords. But in terms of your original question, I don't think I have a specific location. I love a good wood, like any foresty things. My character travels a lot through woods, and I'm surrounded by wood in my natural
life. This is so funny, actually, that this is the conversation we're having today. I felt like I picked this shop talk conversation out of thin air, but I'm realizing yesterday my sister and I had such an interesting conversation about boreal forests, which I've always loved the word taiga, which I always thought was like what happens between a boreal forest and tundra. Like I thought it was that transition period, the way a savanna is the transition between a prairie and a desert. But taiga is just another word for boreal forest. For anybody who doesn't know, boreal forest means like northern cold forest. But then also my sister and I were talking about swamps and how like we like a swamp, but not a Louisiana swamp where they're like mosquitoes, but like a Welsh swamp where it's like kind of cold, like a bog, you know, where you could find like bog butter. And then I went on a whole deep dive about bog butter, which is like, all right, we're getting so off track right now, but I have to tell people this. Scientists find, like, people long ago used to store food in bogs because it's like antibacterial, I guess. I don't know. But scientists find like 1,000-year-old bog butter, like butter in the bog. Ew. And I'm pretty sure they've eaten it. Like,
that sounds very unsanitary.
For science, because they say it has a very musky, gamey, salami taste.
I don't know.
So anyway.
I mean, I guess it does wonders for like your, what's it, bacteria and cheese and dairy called?
Gut?
Yeah, for your gut. Yeah, gut bacteria. I guess it does wonders for that. Unless you get like the plague and then die. I don't know. I'm not a scientist.
Yeah. But anyway, so if anybody's like has bogs in their story,
I do.
Introduce bog butter, Steve.
Maybe I will. Only have, because Vikings used to extract iron from bogs, so I've incorporated that into my story.
That's cool.
But maybe I'll just add some little bog butter moments too.
Yeah. Anyway, sorry for that really random tangent. Stig, thanks so much for your answers. Do you have any further thoughts on importance of location to you, writing versus reading?
I talked about my writing, but in terms of reading, I read a lot of fantasy, and I just love a good, like, religious of any kind of way, shape, or form location. So any kind of temple, especially if it's, like, beaten, ancient, you know, a good treasure hunt. Like that sort of location really speaks to me as a human being. So I love a good like a fallen ruin.
Oh, what about that speaks to you?
I don't know. I think it's just the mysticism. Like the, not afterthought, what am I, like the echo of something that used to be there, I just find really fascinating.
I love like, that.
A city overtaken by a forest, for example. Oh, sign me the fuck up. I like that.
Nice.
So that, I love to read that stuff. And in terms of, yeah, as I said, as a reader, I really easily connect with like the visual of a scene, but scent just means nothing to me. Like if you write, it smells like an apple cake, I just picture an apple cake. I don't smell an apple cake. That's, or like, so get the sensation of like whatever I smell when I smell apple cake, if that makes sense.
When I say, though, something like, you know, his hands were calloused and felt like sandpaper, can you, like, does that elicit something in you, the sense of touch? Like,
yeah, okay. I can kind of feel that.
Okay. And then obviously, if I say, like, you know, there were birds chirping, that's something that you can see in your mind palace.
Yeah, I also love a good, is, I don't know if that counts, but I love a good bird motif in a book.
A bird motif?
Yeah. I've done that specifically, deliberately in my novel. Like, every part has one bird appearance.
Oh.
Just as a symbolic thing. And I just, I think it's fun.
How do you use birds as symbolism?
I think it's easier to just explain with examples, but my main character observes an albatross in Act 1, and Act 1 is very much about, like, dread and drowning and, like, metaphorically drowning and becoming someone else.
Yeah.
I have a magpie in Act 3 kind of foreboding the war that's to come, stuff like that. I just, I was like, will anyone pick up on it? I'm now spoken it aloud. But for the 12 people not present, I don't know if it's like super noticeable.
For the 12 people not present, everyone on Earth is watching this except for 12 people.
I meant for the 12, for the billions of people not watching. Is there a billion people in the world? No. That feels like a lot.
Yes, there are 9 billion people, I think.
Oh, wow. Okay, slay. Well, not slay, actually. The world is burning. Unslay.
Okay, anyway, thank you, Stieg. I'm going to go to the comments for a little bit. I feel like, Stieg, that might have been your and Mai's like most collaborative Sprints and Shop Talk combo yet. Actually, though, I feel like I finally found a topic that you, that is really good for you.
What a beautiful songstress.
There are fairies in my forest, so you might hear them a bit because my windows are open. Laura says, I write at my kitchen table in bed, in the bathtub, on a plane, at the library, at the cafe. I mostly read in the bed or the bath. Thank you, Laura. I meant mostly like location within your story, but I also love that this is how you interpreted the question because this is brilliant. Also, you write in the bathtub? What? Like, please tell me your computer's not plugged in.
She writes on an old-fashioned typewriter with ink.
Yeah, practice bathtub safety, guys. Electronics in the bathtub, it's sketchy. It's sketchy. Gay says, location is so important to me, if only because I have white room syndrome going on up there. Knowing how a certain location looks and feels makes it so much easier to write. Also, I just love locations in general. They can be utilized for great visual storytelling, reading. I don't give a F, mostly because I have white room syndrome going on up there. So how do you fix that? Like, do you use Pinterest? Do you Google places? Do you go on Google Maps and, like, look at actual locations? Do you go and visit those locations? Wait, is this a question that I'm going to ask in the future? whatever. Answer the things I asked. Okay. Jess says, it depends on the story I'm reading / writing and what the book tried to sell me. That's an interesting thought, that books try to sell you things. I can like a bland white room story as much as a sensory overload story. Just depends on what I'm expecting. That's one thing for gays. I think I incorporate a lot of nature, mountains and grasslands specifically, and crumbling ruins because I grew up on like a secluded and dying village.
Oh, God.
Interesting.
Filing that away.
Very interesting. I'm going to write that down. Gays would eat bog butter. Yeah, I'm telling you, bog butter is a real thing. No, I was not talking about bog bodies. That is also a thing. Bogs mummify people. If you fall in, you don't.
That's a famous like Viking found in Norway that was I don't know if it was buried in a bog, but
probably murdered in a bog and left there.
That is also fair.
Yeah. But yeah, it's bog butter. Bog butter. Anna showed up. Kelly says, I so need to get some bog butter going on in my work in progress. Go for it, you guys. Suddenly we're all just gonna incorporate bog butter and it'll be like
it's gonna be a resurgent
weird, weird phenomenon of like, why is this one select group of people all putting bog butter in their stories? Let's have that all be a literary theme. I will be isolated women and bog butter in all my stories. In all my stories.
I'll be parental trauma and bog butter.
Yeah. All right. Y'all are experiencing entire emotions with description. And I'm here like, oh yes, the words on the page sure do make me feel. I always find it so strange that people can create images in their minds. Like, do you honestly see a bird chirping? Well, I can hear a bird chirping. That's like when, like, but then if someone says, look on the table and there's a bird chirping, I can like, I don't see it, but I see it. You know, I can, there's his little feet and his little silvery black wing. And I don't know, I can see it. Anyway.
Do you get like a movie in your head when you read?
Oh yeah. Oh, okay, it's full too. Movie. It's full movie. And then when I get pulled out of it, I'm like, like, I mean, it's disorienting to kind of come back to reality. Yeah. And I know people, I know that there was like a thing on the internet, like in 2021 about people realizing that there is a good chunk of the population that really doesn't have that. It's just like, yeah, they just don't have that. What I find really interesting is that there are quite a few writers who mention that they have that. And I think that's really interesting. And I would love to like go into a book knowing if the writer has that or not, and like how that affects writing style. Cause I think that's really interesting.
It is very interesting.
Catherine.
Hi.
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 Hi. How important is location setting to you when you write? And how about when you read? Also, your lips and sound are delayed ever so slightly. I don't know why.
Great. I love that.
Nope, she's better. She's fixed.
Oh, good. Oh,
fantastic. I think it was just because you were muted. I think StreamYard was doing that thing that it sometimes does.
That sometimes does. Okay, so when I write, location is very important to me, but I don't think I'm particularly good at like describing like an overall location. Like, I think I struggle with like giving the vibe of like a place, and like I really have to like work on like doing that more, and like it's a very conscious effort, whereas like with a lot of other things that I write, it's not as conscious for me. And so like I know internally when I'm writing, like, oh, I should like be describing like what this room looks like, or what like the vibes are of the room, like what it looks like more like visually. Whereas like if I'm like describing like what a character looks like or what like the feelings are, it comes very naturally to me. I don't have to like think about it. But when I'm reading, I love a book with lots of description. It always like grounds me within a story, like location and like place. I really like books that have like, it feels like when I'm in the character's head, it feels like the rest of the world does exist outside of them. And like that there's no borders to like, because sometimes I read stories and I'm like, okay, this feels like it's a singular room happening right now. And I like, there's no world existing outside. But like, I like books that kind of feel like it sprawls beyond just the narrator.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's very difficult to do. And I feel like I'm not very good at it.
And I kind of want to like go over some of the same questions that I asked Stieg with you. So do you find the way you have themes within your writing, do you think you have themes within your locations?
I don't know. I think I always struggle with like self-described themes. Sorry, I'm making
I have one for you.
Okay. I was like, you have something to say.
You love a good hotel room.
You know what? You're right.
Okay. Please expand on that, Steve.
It's just she has a lot of hotel rooms in her stories. And I mean, I get why, but also I think it's fascinating.
Wait, give some examples.
I don't know how many examples I can give without like spoiling spoilers. But a lot of the work involves hotel rooms for natural reasons, but it is definitely like a motif of. And also, can I ask another question?
always.
So obviously you came into like contemporary from this like very high fantasy setting. Do you treat writing fantasy locations differently from writing contemporary settings? Because obviously, like if you say hotel room, people like imagine hotel room, but if you say bloody city with, you know, dead people on the street, people might might not identify with that as easy.
Might not be able to, you know, pull from personal experience on that one.
Yeah. So do you like go into that differently? Do you have like a consciously differently approach to writing contemporary versus writing fantasy?
I don't have a conscious, like, I think when I first started, I approached it very similarly to how I write fantasy things, where like I feel like I was over describing a lot of the places because like, but I also found it much easier because, for example, in Cruel Summer, the characters go to a museum that exists in real life. So like I was able to go and look at the 3D like tour of like the entrance of the museum and a couple of the exhibits and like specifically pull very defined, definite like things from it, like just a couple to like fully, you know, because like I was able to be there, and like if someone Googled this museum, they would also be able to go and actually see it. Whereas with fantasy, I can't do that. I can't be like, you know, here's this thing that exists in real life. Like I can describe it and like give it like an adjacent to it. Like if I could say like a cathedral, people will have an idea of what, you know, like they'll think like Notre Dame or something like that. Like they'll think stained glass windows and stuff. But like I also will have to, you know, dive a little bit deeper into the actual like description and like what things look like. Like, you know, if I say like, you know, flying buttresses, like I can't just be like, you know, here's this museum, you know, and you can Google it. Whereas like if I say, oh, this is the palace of whatever, you know, and like I have to like more physically describe it so people can see it better. So contemporary has a lot more shortcuts, I find, than fantasy. And fantasy, I think that's why I struggle with writing place and location in fantasy as opposed to contemporary, because the contemporary is a lot easier because, again, the people already have those like mental images in their minds of what it is. So,
do you ever lean into that in contemporary where you're like, oh, people can just Google this museum, so I'm not going to bother to describe it properly?
No, I don't think I do, but I do. I don't feel like I have to like describe like the full, like I don't have to be like, oh, it's a box, a boxy shaped place. I can just be like, they're going to this museum, and then I can like, you know, pick and choose what details to describe, which I guess I can also do in fantasy. But like, you know, when I say museum, everyone has an idea of how big a museum is and like what like the outside of a museum looks like. That's less important than actually like
the character interactions and stuff.
Yeah. So like I and I always think about when it, like this is for everything I do. I always think about how would the character describe this? So, you know, like I'm specifically thinking of Invisible String. They go to a museum. There's a lot of museums also in my books. Hotel rooms and museums. That's my vibe. And he specifically will describe things like in a way that like also like is subtly hinting at what he thinks about the other character that he's going with. And so like he's kind of framing museum around how he sees his eventual love interest, essentially.
Do you do that in fantasy? Because that's one of my like favorite things, is when like the location reflects the characters or the interactions. That's one of my favorite bits. Do you ever do that in your like stories?
I try to, but again, it's like one of those things where it's very conscious that I'm trying to do that. Like I really have to think about it. And like, sometimes if I'm like just blitz writing something, like I don't think about it. Like if I'm like absolutely trying to pound out words just to get the draft done, I feel like that is the first thing that falls on the wayside, because that's not something that like I consciously like can't, or I can do subconsciously while I'm just writing. But it is something I love to do. I just have to like really think about it, be like, how would this character like interact with this new environment? Cause like, I'm thinking of the Wrath King specifically. There are a couple of characters, one of the main characters is new to the city. So like her description of the city and the things that she sees will be reflected, you know, in the fact that she's never seen it before. Whereas like another character who grew up in the city, like will notice other things that are deeper in the city, like being like, you know, I don't, you know, look at all these, like, there's a bunch of homeless people now that were never there before. And like, maybe we should help them. Whereas like this princess or whatever, this lady, you know, would be thinking, like, looking at the, you know, beautiful towers and stuff and thinking about how much it looks different than her homeland. So that's also another way that I do it is, like, you know, I think about the place that they're at, but then also the place that they came from and how would they, like, compare and contrast them? Does it feel familiar? Does it feel really different? Does it feel like something that's, you know, they're really, you know, drawn to? Like, if they're in a city and they hate cities, like, they're going to be noticing all the things that make them feel, like, claustrophobic, or, like, they're really, really small, or, like, you know, like, they're going to be stepped on. Whereas, like, if they're in the country, maybe they feel freer, or vice versa, you know, whatever you want.
Okay, and one last question, I promise, and I'm so sorry for, like, backseat driving this conversation.
I love it. I
love that.
When you write fantasy locations, because you, like, you, I think you're a great writer, and, like, locations and characters, you do really well, but do you ever, like, think about, okay, so I'm going to write a cathedral, obviously, and it's fantasy. Do you ever, like, think, oh, I'm going to, like, do one odd thing with this location that makes it stand out, like, from
what we would consider a cathedral?
I think so. I think one of the, well, so the example that immediately springs to mind is in The Wrath King, and the Wrath King's world is very based on blood magic and, like, blood, and, like, so the castle, the heart of the city, the palace, is shaped like an anatomical heart and has, like, wings of it that are based on, like, heart descriptions and stuff. So, like, that was something I was trying to do was, like, you know, this society is very focused on this one thing. So, like, how can I change the shape of something? And also then it's a, you know, reference for anyone who knows what an anatomical heart looks like. Like, you can kind of visualize what kind of a inorganic structure would look like, or what they would try to do to make an inorganic structure look like an organic thing. And then it's also related to the themes of the society. So I do try to think about, like, what would be interesting here? Or, like, what would I want to see in real life? Like, you know, would I want to see a cathedral that has, like, an entirely, like, glass interior or an exterior? Like, that would be cool. Let's put it in there. Why not?
Okay. No further questions, Your Honor. Thank you so much for your time.
That was awesome. Thank you. And then my one final question for Katie will be kind of similar to Steve's. You are from Pennsylvania, which has maybe not quite as dramatic a backdrop as Norway, but there are still mountains with a rich history of mining and forests. And so I'm just wondering how you, if you, and how you pull from your current location to feed your writing.
I do try to do that. I love... So, can you not chew on my chair, please? Don't chew on that. Thank you. sorry. So I do try to pull from it. I love driving in Pennsylvania. I love driving in general, but love driving in Pennsylvania. And there's a lot of, like, you know, roads that are, like, winding, and they, like, take you up, and, like, you can kind of see, like, the dips and the valleys and the way that the mountains kind of, like, kind of wave through the, you know, if you're up higher, obviously you can see the mountains. Duh. And so when I was a kid, actually, and I would sit in the back seat and I would look out, I would always be able to, like, imagine or, like, pretend of, like, a dragon, like, flying across, like, there, and, like, the shadow that would, like, cool, like, how the shadow would form over the mountains and how that would look. And so I've always been very that's one thing that I love about my, you know, if I ever wrote a dragon book, is that I would end up, it would be, like, kind of like Pennsylvania, because I do think I have, like, this, I don't know, it feels like you're flying, and, like, you can fly over the mountains, and, like, I think the shape of the wings and, like, the body and, like, the tail over the way the mountains form would be really cool. And I think one thing about Appalachia that I think anyone who lives here would know is that there's a very specific, like, vibe to the forests, and, like, a very specific, like, you know, if you hear your name being called in the forest and you're alone, no, you didn't. Like, if you saw something, no, you didn't. Like, there is some old stuff.
Sir. Also, not to do a circle jerk while she's dealing with Blue, but the very most northern tip of the Appalachian Forest in the United States is taiga, for people who are curious to, you know, come back to that, what we were talking about earlier.
There we go. So I think there is a very, like, distinct, like, the Appalachian Mountains feel very much like, I don't want to say they're, like, they're alive, but almost like they're, you know, there's something there inside of them. Mm-hmm. And, like, you know, you can go looking for it, but you might not like what you find, kind of vibe. Mm-hmm. And it's very, like, creepy and mysterious. But there's also, like, if you've grown up here, it, for me, for example, I've lived in Pennsylvania my whole life. Stop chewing my chair, please. Thank you. Is that they also feel like home. So, like, you know, I don't feel like, it doesn't feel like scary to live in the mountains and, like, be in, you know, the darkest parts of the forests and stuff. Because, like, I don't know. Anyway, the vibes of the mountains I could go on forever about, but because I love them. And I will defend them that they're mountains because they are. It may not be crazy, but they are mountains and they're, like, some of the oldest shit in the world. So, like, I don't know. Sometimes it feels like you can feel, like, that they've been here for a while and they've seen some shit.
Excellent. Thank you, Katie and Stieg, for that great back and forth. Thank you very much. That was awesome.
I love that. I had such a fun time.
I'm trying to find where I stopped in the comments. There have been a lot of more ones. A lot of more ones. That was not a well-constructed sentence. Maybe here? It does depend on the story, the moment. There are descriptions that stand out as immersive and ones that stand out as distracting. The problem is the good ones just become part of the experience. Why is that a problem? I do not understand. I do use other resources to replace my white room syndrome. I use Pinterest, but I also love experiencing locations so much more, mostly because I can then retell it in a way if I'm most interesting. That is super true. One of the stories I'm working on, a good portion of it takes place in a mall, and the mall is a real location, but it's a mall in Rhode Island. Okay. My experience with malls has always been in Texas. Everything's bigger in Texas, you guys. So when I was writing the story, and even though I had gone on Google and I'd looked at it and stuff, I still had my preconceived notion of what a mall was. So I'm writing about these really long hallways and all these nooks and crannies that the girl kind of explores and stuff like that. And then last October, I actually was in Rhode Island. So I went on location and I visited the location. And the mall is teeny tiny. I mean, you can basically full wingspan, like, almost touch like that, like the storefronts when you're standing in the main hallway of the mall. And I was like, oh wow, I really have to rethink this setting. So there is something really, if you're writing about a real place in this world, you know, with fantasy, you can have something based off a place and then make it your own. But if you're writing about a real place in this world where potentially people from this place are going to read it, there is something to be said for an actual on-location visit. So those people who are from that place and very familiar with it don't go like, this author clearly never actually came here, you know?
Me with any medical stuff in novels.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. A lot of people talking about the kind of syndrome where you can't, not syndrome, but that.
Condition? Question mark?
Is it a condition? Like, it's just a feature.
State of being?
Or it's like a lack of a feature. I don't know. Yeah, state of being, where you don't have that internal movie. A lot of people are mentioning that. When he says, also, I do experience the senses given like temperature, touch, sound, smell is a little different in that I more experience the reaction I might have to that smell. Laura says, because I asked her a question, she's responding to it. I've searched for walkthroughs on YouTube of specific caves that are in one of my stories. Very helpful. Google Maps is also good. I like to have the environment interact with my characters. Have the dust plume around their booted feet. The sand in the wind eat at the lace in their dress. Taking notes. Lighting in the locations on the characters. Give me a good slash light across the villain's eyes. A lantern me. Poor baby. Bathing the dull world in technicolor. Things like that. See, Laura, this is why I'm so interested that you specifically say you don't see images in your head, because I feel like your imagery is, to be sure, you're just like, oh, it's about to be me? Bye. Yeah, like, I find it so interesting that you have this, and yet you create such intense mental imagery for me. You know, when I read what you just wrote, I could see all that very clearly. And I feel like my mind fills in the gap, right? A slash of light across the villain's eyes. For some reason to me, like that light, it's sunlight, which means it's like a bright sunny day outside, which means we're inside maybe a cool dark room with that light coming through the door, but I know that it's warm outside and that like temperature differential, like to me, I feel that so vividly.
Same.
That's so interesting to me that she can create such intense descriptions and yet not actually see them in her own head. Gay says, in the Jim Gott story, I utilize a lot of folklore style descriptions. I pull my descriptions mostly from Italian and Greek and Eastern European fairy tales, now that I think about it. Appalachian forests are creepy. I don't know if they're creepy. I can read or write anywhere, but I do prefer to write where I know I will have less distractions, like my office. Okay, this is so interesting. Because Nia has interpreted the question the same way that Laura did. Yeah, so when I was making the question, yeah, I was thinking more about location, like within the story, like the location of a scene, not location for you as a writer. But I totally see now how this question is reading this way of like, yeah, I see that I worded this question not very well, but that is totally fine.
It is funny though that both me and Stieg took it the same way.
What I was talking about. Well, but I think that's because you also had the context of the other two questions, because you know what the other two questions are.
Oh, that's also true.
So I think that's probably what that.
I mean, all of them have access to the same question.
Yeah, the questions are in the description for anybody who doesn't know that the questions. I've decided to put the questions in the description because I didn't want to write a real description, so I was like, I'll just put the questions in. I'm like so lost on what some things are being said. Hold on, does anybody know this?
Sorry. Yeah, so Wendy was like, "What did Wendy?" I know what they mean. They said like something like the problem is that like. I think it's just that the immersive details become so deep ingrained that they can't specifically call out like, oh, this is specifically what this author did well.
Yeah.
Because they're so into it. So that's how they know it's good, but they can't describe why it's good because it just is good.
I got
I think.
Thank you. When I write, I use mood boards, etc., but I don't need to be in the actual space. Nice. See, I find that I flourish, even though I have the ability to conjure images in my head. That is so interesting. Like other people's writing can conjure those images. And when I read my writing that I wrote like a while ago, when I'm removed from it, I can conjure images. But I can't just sit there like trying to write a scene and be like, okay, closing my eyes. And I'm just going to easily create the scene and just write what I see in my head. Like that's really hard for me, which is why I really thrive when I'm up in this cabin with family, because so, like I said, so many of my stories take place in this location. And so I really have it all right in front of me and I can really be in the setting. This is crazy. Like, oh, you have the opposite. You can see them in your head, but that can lead me to leave out details because I see it and forget to add it. That is super interesting too. That's super interesting. Also, no worries, Grape. I know you have to leave, but I was just teasing you. Okay. What were you gonna say, Katie?
I was just going to say that like most things in writing, it takes a lot of time to like build things. So like, I find that like with a lot of things, like if I have like specific details and then I go back and I'm editing and I'm like reading it and I'm like, there's something missing. Like I have to build some of the descriptions and the pieces on top of each other to like fully get that atmosphere. So like, you know, with a lot of things, I feel like I just, you know, my drafts are very clean. My drafts are usually pretty like complete when I finish them, but like location and scene and stuff are things that I have to like build upon in future drafts in order to make sure it all like, because like I can feel there's something missing if I don't add all the details, and like I'll have to like figure out like which details specifically are not clicking in my brain, because I also see everything when I'm reading it. I'm like, why is this thing not going where I want it to go? Like, why is it not weaving together in the way that it should?
So. Yeah, I love that. Thank you. All right, is everybody ready for the next sprint?
Aye, aye, Captain.
And also for anybody who's like, well, you didn't answer the question, I will think you will find I did. Throughout this conversation, I feel like I answered the question. All right. Also, once again, I'm using all my own timers just because I am paranoid about the, like, the copyright strikes. I just feel like one day Violet's going to get violent.
And she will shut us down so fast.
Yeah, she really could.
In the water.
She and Laura and Marta hold a lot of power over us, actually.
Yeah.
We exist by their grace. All right. Happy sprinting, everybody. See you in 25. 24, 57, 56, 55. it's not the worldwide run-a-thon, but that's fine. How do I stop crying? There we go. Excellent. That's the end of our second sprint. How did everybody do?
I got through another 20 pages.
Stunning.
And I ended just on an chapter cliffhanger where the main character is about to read some very personal letters. So that's I'm like getting excited to read the letters in the next chapter.
We love a kind of spoiler moment. That's exciting.
Mm-hmm. What did you say?
I said we love a good epistolary moment.
Ah, yes. And I'm very nosy, so it just speaks to me as a nosy person to read other people's letters, even though they're fake letters, but I'm like, yes.
Katie, how'd you do?
I did good. I'm up to, 638 words. And if I had a nickel for every time I put Brendan Fraser's The Mummy in a book, I would have 2 nickels, which isn't a lot, but it's weird that it's happened twice.
I mean, why not?
Why not? All right. Why not?
And I continued to do my editing. I did go back and I re-added in a little bit of that explanatory bridge. And I also did what Stieg recommended, where I took some of the items and just sprinkled them throughout the conversation as like asides of explanation. But it's a little clunky. So Katie, when I send you this chapter, this is chapter 4 that I'm reviewing right now. So it's not the next chapter I'll send you, but the chapter after that, I'll need your opinion on it. But I deleted a whole bunch of words and I ended with 92 words. So I'm thinking I actually like wrote about 300 something words that sprint and beyond just the editing. So yeah. It was a good start. And I'm like really feeling it. And also, can I just say that she has worked on this story for at least 1 hour a day for this entire week. And I have to say, considering where I was last year with my relationship with writing and like ability to work, we're thriving, you guys.
I'm so happy for you.
Thank you. I'm very pleased, very pleased.
Wait, hold on.
Oh, do I get a yay? Nice. Yay, that one's even better. I love that one. That is nice. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Katie. Thank you.
You're welcome.
We did have some people show up. Malin's here, but on like slightly iffy internet.
Bonjour.
Bonjour. It could be the worldwide marathon. We are all here, aren't we, John?
You're so right.
Malin's in her new house and it's all empty and there's no Wi-Fi. Malin, can I make a request? Can I make a little request? I know your channel is an author tube channel, but hear me out. House tour. Hear me out. Kitchen tour. Hear me out. Everything for it. If you want, you could make it unlisted and then drop the link in the Discord. Or just drop the link in my DMs, babe. Because here's the thing. I'm about to move, like in less than a month. I'm going to be loading up a car and driving cross country and I'll be doing my own move. And I am obsessively watching like empty house tours, empty apartment tours, kitchen tours. I'm like, that is what I'm watching right now to like veg out. Oh, and I just love to veg out to your house specifically. Talk about nosy. Stieg reads people's letters. I like to look at people's houses. What are you doing in there? How are you decorating? What's going on? Where'd
What's
you get
your
that
vibe? Yeah, like, let me be nosy.
Why is the door to the basement locked?
Yeah. Yeah. Anna's very intrigued by Steve's beta reading excursions. I wonder why. No idea why she would be interested in that at all. Limped through the chapter. But limping is still movement. The ending kind of trails off. As somebody who literally just limped hundreds of miles, I can tell you that even if you're limping, you can still get pretty far. The ending kind of trails off. I hope when I plot out the next chapter, I'll figure out how to end this one. Yeah. Okay, maybe I'll just do a phone one.
Yes,
hell yeah. Please. I did one for my mom on WhatsApp on 5. So 5G here is good. Oh, nice.
Slay. Yeah.
House tour. Let's all do the chant, everybody, even in the comments. House tour. Oh, McDonald's for lunch or eat the potatoes, cabbage sausage that you brought. We are in our economic girly era.
Yeah.
Oh. Oh. Should I just abandon? Yes. Oh, okay. Should I just abandon AuthorTube and make my channel like a lifestyle channel? But okay.
Do you like both? Angle it into AuthorTube somehow? Like,
but here's the thing, like,
drive across country and throw books out the window.
I'm specifically, there are lots of reasons that I'm moving cross country, but one of the reasons I'm moving cross country is because I'm moving to the place where one of my books takes place. So it's like totally related. I'm like, watch me move to my book's location.
That would be so extra. I would be so obsessed with that.
I mean, She is a committed girly. Yeah. Haha, the chaotic chant. Very
cult. Is it called method cluttish. Acting? You're very a method
cluttish, writer. You guys. We're very cluttish today.
We're not a cult. We're a clut. We're
a clut. Oh, man, Malin, you've done it now.
Did you find a new horse to beat?
Yes.
Welcome to the clut.
Oh, I love this word because it's ever so slightly skewed a clit.
I'm just thinking clutter. That's what I was thinking.
Oh, interesting.
You need to declut.
You need to declit.
Not declit. Declut.
Yeah, genital mutilation is not cool.
It's true. That is true.
It's a violation of human rights.
Yeah.
Oh, I just got really nauseous. I have no idea why.
Because we're talking about genital mutilation, probably.
I'm like breaking out into a hot sweat. I just got so nauseous. Hold on. Katie, will you take over? I'm going to take a Zofran.
Yeah. Justice, I'm going to be economical. But be economical, babe. Do it.
Do it for us. Do it for Tom.
We're living my dream, Wallace, as gays. Either I'm ordering lunch today or tomorrow. Do it tomorrow because tomorrow can be a reward for our 10K weekend thing, you know, because we're doing get all the words.
Excuse me. Well, at least I was not invited to a 10K.
There's a write-a-thon happening.
Oh, yeah. Is there? Oh, it's a write-a-thon.
You're more than welcome to join. I mean, it's hosted by Jess.
Yes. And Anne Sophie. You. It's on the calendar. And Anne, right?
And Anne, yeah.
I can't open my Zofran, you guys. I'm going to throw up.
My first instinct was like, give it to me. I'll open it.
I got it.
Okay.
Katie, will you also leave the... Here we go. Katie, go for it.
Okay, Stieg, walk us through one of your story's locations. What elements are most important to you when setting a scene?
This is such a mean question because I'm so bad at description. But I did think about a location for this. And I want to walk you through a bridge in my work.
A bridge, okay.
Yes. The bridge is very pivotal to the break into two part. And you're standing on a bridge. I don't know what you meant by this question, but I'm just going to... You're just going to have to close your eyes and go on a journey with this.
Yeah, like, give me every visual detail. Like, describe it to me. I want to be able to see it in my mind's eye.
You're standing on the bridge, and there's a tower in front of you on the bridge. A tower bridge, if you will. And on the tower is written, actually carved in stone, the word obedience.
Okay.
Under the bridge is a grate. Is that what it's called? Like an iron portcullis grate situation? Like an iron gate. Like a grid.
Oh, off. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, no, I got it.
Yes. So that's closed off because you're trying to escape, baby, but you can't. So you're on this bridge looking at the word obedience, and the word obedience has gone through your entire life. And you're like, I don't want to be obedient. But behind the bridge, you see a castle towering on a hill. Okay. The castle is your family home, the royal palace. And around the home, there's draped a city. So the castle is on top, just like the king is on top of a nation. And then below the castle are the great houses. So there's like big gardens, big trees. You can see some greenery poking up through like the city walls. And outside the walls are the stores and the like poorer quarters of fishermen, even some farmers that do garden farming inside the city. But between you and this gatehouse that says obedience, there's guards. And then you have to do the choice. Do you let them capture you or do you jump over the edge of the bridge to whatever may be down there? That is the walkthrough. So not very descriptive in terms of emotions or like sense or just visuals.
Like what kind of bridge is it? Is it like a stone bridge?
It's
like
a stone bridge. It is a six arch stone bridge stretching, the only bridge actually, from the capital city to the mainland.
Steve, can I just say, that your description reminded me a lot of the capital city of Slovenia, Ljubljana, because they have a castle up high on a hill and the city is nestled around it in kind of a semicircle kind of fashion. So I'm just letting you know about that.
Okay. Well, my story is inspired by Mont Saint-Michel Abbey.
Oh, sure. That. The place. The place with the water, the yes. tide.
But I didn't have a tidal island. I just made a bridge.
Okay. Very cool. Have you ever been?
No. Only Google Google Translate. That's not the word. Google Maps. There you go.
Cool. Katie, thank you for rescuing me for a second. I really needed to lie down.
You're welcome.
All right. So you kind of, I feel like we've all really discussed this last, what elements are most important to you in setting a scene. Or at least I feel like Katie really went into it. Stieg, we talked about a lot and we might have covered for you what elements are most important to you in setting a scene. But do you have anything you want to add?
Not that I can think of what is important to me. I'm such like a police report writer and I've talked about this, so mm-hmm. it's really just descriptions for me. And then in revisions I go in and then I add emotion and character stuff and that.
Got it. And why is this the location you chose to share with us today?
Just because I think it's kind of shows what we talk about in terms of like Catherine's having like the environment being sort of a metaphor for the like characters and discussion going on. Like you have this island with a palace on top, like just the king on top of a society.
I love
you
have that. This
bridge. So, you know, bridge between part one and part two, like act one and act two. And then you have to choose like, and that's like a big deal of the segue between act one and act two is like the choice the hero makes. Mm. So I want to just kind of hammer down all the metaphors I could, because God help me, I need it.
Yeah, metaphors are good. Metaphors offer us a good filter to not directly deal with our trauma. Anyway, thank you. Looks like not a ton of people have actually answered the question, so I'm just going to go ahead and go straight to Katie. Walk us through one of your story locations. And you really did answer this second part of the question when you were answering the first, but I loved the conversation that was happening between you and Stieg, so I wasn't going to shut it down. So you can just really focus on walking us through one of your story locations.
This is great, because I didn't think about this question at all. This was the question I did not think of.
No.
Great. I'm trying to think, because I think, well, okay. I have been struggling actually with not location, but like, so lake actually is set at a lake.
Actually?
Actually, I know, right? Who would have thought with the title? But I feel like when I'm actually writing the story, not a whole lot of like lake description is happening or like setting location is happening, because a lot of it is just at like cottages and cabins and stuff. Although I guess, okay, so one of the, so this is the, never mind, I've gathered it in my bullshitting for 3 seconds.
Nice. She's like, okay, wait, I have my actual answer now.
We got there. Because I was thinking about it, I was like, I don't really think I describe any of them, but that's actually a lie. So, one of the groundskeeper, there's two cottages that are next to each other. They used to be connected, but then they're renovated to be two different cottages. Roughly the same size. And so, the groundskeeper, like the original groundskeeper, is in one of them and his son lives in the other one. Mm-hmm. And so his son's one of the main characters. And so when his father was married to his mother, he converted the second cottage into like this artistic studio for her, because she was an artist. She loved to paint, she loved to do sculptures and stuff. So he outfitted the entire place to kind of have this like artist vibe. So like there's like a front room that looks out over the lake, and it's the walls are entirely made of glass. It's kind of like a solarium. And so our main character, Matt, is a big gardener. He loves to garden. So he has all these house plants. And so it's very much like this, what do you call it? Not conservatory. Is it a conservatory?
conservatory. Yeah.
Conservatory for like plants and stars and stuff?
Yes. So it's very much a conservatory vibe.
Ours is an observatory.
Oh. Hmm?
He said for plants and stars and stuff.
Oh. I guess you
can see this. You can see the stars in the conservatory through the glass windows.
Mm. That's true. You could have like a telescope in there. So yeah, it's become kind of his like sanctuary place, but it is very unusual in the way that there's a lot of glass and a lot of things, but you could just see, you know, the outside. And it's also, you know, I'm realizing now it's a little bit more of a metaphor because he's always kind of been the, outside looking in or inside looking out when it comes to everyone else who lives at the lake, because, you know, the people who come to be at the lake are only there for the summer and he lives there year round. So he's kind of like watching them experience their like fun summers, and he's just still always working at the lake, you know, like this is his home, this is his place, like this isn't like a summer vacation for him. Mm-hmm. So there you go, that's one of the cottages that is very integral to the one of the plot lines of Lake Actually.
I love that. Devesha, are you here?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to, just in case your internet goes out, I'm going to let you answer the question as well before I go into the comments, if you'd like.
Pass.
All right. Thanks for being here, Devesha. We always just love, you know, your added spice. Okay. Anastasia.
Sorry, I didn't do the homework and I needed more time to think about the question.
Okay. I will go ahead and answer some of the comments then and then come back to you. Anna says, I feel like I'm always including lighting. It's the simmer in me. It's cozy lamps in a dim study, big windows with pouring in sunshine, atmosphere shortcut right there. Kay says, so imagine a sea, but instead of water, there's grass as tall as your highest guard. Ooh, I love that description. Mm-hmm. The higher, the deeper you go in. You cannot go far into it without alerting the monsters within the tall grass. No one's ever killed these monsters, but whoever gets swallowed by the sea, they're lost forever. They call it the jeweled gates of the underworld because from up high on Dragonback, the sea of tall grass shines to light in too many colors. And you know those are either people's bones or their eyes. She's a writer. Holy shit. Oh my God, bro. I can't even get into my story locations or I won't ever shut up. I mean, comments are open. Juan says, probably one of the places I described the most in space. Actually, guys, this was amazing. Thank you for this, by the way. You left Katie speechless.
Yeah.
Katie, would you like to comment? Would you like to say something?
I am truly speechless, which is hard for me. But I need that in my hand. I need the story in my hands immediately.
Yeah, very interested. Well, it says, probably one of the places I describe the most in Space Princess is Core 12, a pirate haven type of space station. I tried to include all five senses when describing it, paying more attention to scents and sounds than normal. I realize it's easy to focus on sight, just on sight. So I do my best to include the other senses when describing important locations. Some of the descriptions of it are on my Insta. Everybody go check it out.
I love Mullen's Instagram.
And Lauren LaVon says, okay, we have guests coming over now. Oh, bye. Gotta catch the rest of Shop Talk in replay. Aw.
Leave your answers in the comments.
Yeah. And Gilly says, Jim Gott's story is in the Outlying Stage, babes. It's a trilogy and I adore it. I love that.
Gimme.
Devesha, have you had time?
Yes, I have time. And somebody's being yelled at. I'm sorry if you can hear that in the background. I'm not really good at story locations. Mm-hmm. So it's never really like, you know, concrete imagery. There's just a lot of vague vibes. Mm-hmm. But the one I was thinking of for this question is in a story that I started brainstorming recently, where it's kind of like this entire Halloween town vibe town.
Stunning. Love it.
Except a little more creepy. Oh, you know when the Is it the second one where everything's gray?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That vibe.
Oh, that's sad.
It's by choice of collective people. Yeah, so I don't really have any like locations, like, you know, a shop here, a shop there. It's kind of just like a vague placement of things. The most important location in that story, I guess, is the surrounding forest, because that's where our romance happens.
Wait, what book is this?
It's called The Beast at Weary's End. I have not talked about it yet.
That's a great title, first of all.
Thank you.
I did want to ask, because one of your books is a pirate book, and I'm assuming a lot of the scenes take place out on the open sea. So I was kind of saying, like, how do you differentiate those scenes, you know, when the surrounding environment, I mean, how are you pulling in?
Well, for a pirate book, a lot of it happens on land.
Oh, brilliant. Fair enough.
I don't.
Fair enough. And also
the difficulties, like, I was like, oh, it's a lot of sea. Let's just, you know, hop to this island and then hop to this town and then.
Yeah. And did you want to take a moment and answer the first question since you weren't able to?
Sure.
You kind of have, but like you kind of say, like, for you as a writer, it's not something you really incorporate a lot of, but how about for you as a reader? How important is it to you?
As a reader, it's not very important to me. I'm more of a connect with the characters type of reader. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, the location and setting and all that stuff kind of falls to the wayside. But I'm really just honed in on the emotionality of things. And I think it's also like that in my writing.
Mm.
It reflects that.
And we were having a whole conversation about people who have internal movies versus who don't. Do you know where you kind of lie on that spectrum? How clearly can you see things in your mind's eye?
Maybe somewhere like in the middle.
Mm.
If it's a thing I've seen enough times that I can kind of construct it, but if you're asking me to like come up with this image from scratch, I can't do such a thing.
Yeah, I think for me it's like AI art, right? Like when someone says visualize a bird, I can sit there and I can like think about all the pieces of a bird. Like I said, like, oh, it's silver feathery wing. Like when I say the silver feathery wing of the bird, I can see that silver feathery wing in my mind's eye, but the outside is like distorted, like AI generated, right? So it's like the bird's got like a weird head, or, you know, I for me it's like the people eating spaghetti with their hands. Like that's why I'm not a good sketch artist. Like I have to see something to draw. I can't just draw something from my imagination, because my imagination can't perfectly replicate things unless I'm reading it, right? Like that's why I think I have such an easy time falling into a story, because I have the movie play out very vividly when I'm reading. But it's also hard for me to write settings because my mind isn't generative, right? Like it can't create, it can create stuff out of thin air, but it takes a lot of work and it's a little fucked up. So do you think that's kind of where you're falling on the spectrum?
Yeah, for sure. Like if you told me to picture an apple, it's like an abstract painting. Like it's very blurry, but there's like the essence of an apple in the middle, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Almost like a scientific chart, right? Like you kind of like no apple over here, apple-ish, right. apple-ish, apple, no apple.
Wow, that's fascinating.
Yeah.
I just see an apple.
I fully see like an apple. Like sitting on a table, and like I can picture like
I have to really focus in. Like someone says apple and I'm like apple, but then I'm like, okay, let's focus in. Like, and then it's like, oh, it's like you're looking through a telescope or a microscope and it starts off blurry, and then as I sit and concentrate, it focuses to a point where I can see that green apple that's been sitting in that fruit bowl that's wooden with a marble base. And of course I'm just thinking that because I just bought a fruit bowl that's wooden with a marble base. But yeah, the stem's broken off and like, but there is still one little leaf, and oh, there's a little bruise in the upper right corner, but light shining off. Like suddenly it's becoming very clear to me, you know? And in this, I've like focused and zoomed in, but it takes effort unless I'm reading, right? When I'm reading that, it's super clear to me because somebody's doing all the effort and the focusing for me. Yeah. All right. And I'm not feeling my best. So we're actually just going to go ahead and quickly do answer or question three, not sprint. Sorry, guys, but I really need to get the stream over with so I can lie down because I'm feeling a little bit nauseous. So really quickly, like rapid fire, what author do you think is the best at creating vibrant locations? Just rapid fire examples.
Samantha Shannon.
Stunning. What lessons have you taken from her style?
To incorporate more senses. She does that a lot.
Mm. Is there one that like an example that specifically sticks out from you from Priory or Day, Fall, and Night that you're like, ooh, yeah.
She uses a lot of touch.
Mm.
So I'm like trying to mentally think of that when I write.
I also like that she uses a lot of, like, even though she's in a fantasy story, she uses a lot of reality. Like, one of the things that really struck me when I was reading it was, this is like a little, it's not spoilery, but it's like a little like, whoa, what is this book about? But one of the handmaidens is watching the queen getting undressed, and the description of the queen's naked body, I was like, wow, yeah, that's like a real woman's naked body, you know, like being observed by another woman. Like, it's not perfection, right? It is like reality. So I thought, I really appreciated that within this fantasy story, there were a lot of moments of like, yeah, that is how that thing is. It's not this like grandiose version of it. So that's something that I picked up from her writing style. Katie, how about you? What author do you think is best at creating vibrant locations?
V.E. Schwab. Yep. I'm predictable. I specifically think of Gallant, her most recent book, because the setting is very much a character in and of itself. Mm. And the main character is an artist, so she tends to like draw portions of it, and the way that's described, that she draws things, is really cool. And also the way she uses the, because so it's set at a manor called Gallant, and you can tell that there's a lot of like mystery and melancholy and nostalgia, and that there's like different generations have like built upon each other within the like story itself. And there's a lot of like and the way she describes it with the like artist's mind is like she describes like the different ways that like ink tones are, and like the sprawling of ink, and like different like ways the shadows are playing off each other and stuff. And I think that's really cool. And it's like the house has a personality depending on where, what portion of the house you're in, and based on like how the light is hitting certain things, and also like day versus night vibes of the house are very different things. And so it very much feels like this encompassing like place that is very much a character in the story. So of course, I mean, it's always going to be V.E. Schwab. I love her.
Devisha, how about you?
I haven't read a single book in my life. vibrant locations. Once again, I'm not really focusing on the locations when I read. I'm just going to say Bradley Sager, because that's the last author I think I've read.
And then I mentioned this last week, I think, but I'm really recently gotten into the, not recently, within the last couple of years, ever since I joined the Daphne du Maurier Society. Daphne du Maurier is very good at creating vibrant locations, but also balancing it well. Because, like, I've read Jane Eyre, I've read Bronte's, and boy, do those romantics love their locations, but boy, do they need an editor, right? It's like, whew, like, this chapter could have been a paragraph.
could have been an email.
I think Daphne du Maurier does a good job of, like, creating the locations, making the locations their own character, but also not bloating her stories. So that's my answer. Quickly gonna go through the comments here. Sorry guys. Crimson Strings is an alternate Earth. So while the countries are the same, there are vampires, mafias, etc. Satan is real and has a palace in hell. The walls themselves listen in, so he is always knows what's going on. There's a library in hell that holds copies of every text ever written, as well as a true history. Shelves descend deep into the earth, constantly being filled by scribes. There is a restricted section, a Nephilim. What does that mean? Library must escort you to.
Isn't like Nephilim just an angel creature or something?
Okay. An angel human.
As the entrance is guarded by shadow demons, it houses truths that would change the world if they got out. That's a cool concept. Mm-hmm. One of the locations in my completed manuscript is the Wild Wood. It is an in-between space that allows people to travel long distances. Not everyone can enter, though. It is also the realm of the Fae.
Oh, that's really cool.
the most important elements when setting scenes are ones that can invoke a feeling like the cozy cottage in the glen. Oh, I love a glen. I love a good glen. There's smoke coming from the chimney, a veggie patch with pixies and the roses. Oh my gosh. What a great evocation. That was great.
Can I go there?
Amanda says, my current setting is a haunted campground near the Oregon coast. Yes, please. My go-to scene setter is usually lighting, but lately I've been leaning into smells. The brine on the breeze or musty soil. Oh, so good, you guys. I literally just figured out where the gem part of gem got all. So in this world, instead of like normal bones, people have gems surrounding their bones, like another protective layer. Oh, damn, that's cool. And they also have gem-like hearts, which is double terrifying when you see a certain blade the antagonist wields in a few locations.
Gimme.
That's funny. This is where Gaze is like, my location inspiration is fanfic authors. That's awesome, actually. Pillar mantle of the Wolf Hall fame. Nice. Everything is so, like, she places descriptions exactly right. Lisa says, me when people ask me name a book. Yeah, fair enough. Y'all, this all sounds so cool. I'm so impressed with all these besties. Yay! Thank you guys for joining us today. I'm sorry it was a bit of a cut short. I'm sorry that my body decided to try to get me a little bit. Does anybody have any final thoughts or words before I end the sprint with Katie's new summertime outro? If I can find it.
Any final? No. Okay, bye. I like how everyone has just their first name in case, and Steve is